And welcome. The first lecture of the day is by Professor Wazin. So this is the second in her series, Obstructions to Rationality and Unramified Gourmand.
So I continue what I started yesterday. In particular, I stated the following rather easy statement, but this is, as I said, the beginning of the whole story. The fact that X is a smooth projective over C, and then I consider the following group. I consider Betti cohomology with Z coefficient and take the torsion, and this is a stable bi-rational invariant of X in the class of smooth projective varieties. Okay. So I'm going to give you the complete proof of this, even if this is easy, simply because it's the model for many other proofs of a similar kind. So first of all, I have to prove that invariance when I recall that a stable birational equivalence is, it includes to say X is equivalent to X cross projective space and also birational equivalence. So first of all, I have to see what happens when I replace X by X cross PR. But in that case, you get that H3 of X cross PR Z is, well, you have the standard projective bundle formula. You have this formula, and H1 with Z coefficient has is always torsion free. And so you conclude that when you take the torsion, you get that isomorphism. And next, now I have to show invariance under birational equivalence. This is a little more tricky. So let me explain a reduction. So the very important point is that it suffices to show. So let's first show the invariance under blow up. So that is, you have an X and you have a Z containing X which is smooth, and you consider the blow up of X along Z. And you want to show that this operation does not change this group. And this is exactly by the corresponding formula, that is the blow-up formula, namely H3 of X tilde Z. Z is the same as H3 of X Z, that is, which is pulled back via the blowing up map. So it's a two upper star of this. And then you have a plus, and here you have to add H1 of Z. Z. And the map from H1 of Z to here, it's by, you blow up your Z, so here you have the exceptional divisor, so now you consider degree one comma Z, you pull it back to A, and then push it forward to X tilde Z. So this is the map from here to here. And then same argument as above, this is, this has no torsion, and so we conclude that when you take torsion, the two groups coincide. And the last point is that this invariance under blow-up is enough to imply the result. Using essentially Yonaka, well, Let me be a little more precise here. So now we want to study the case of a general birational map. So what Hironaka will tell you is that you can do this. So to tell the truth here, I could use also the weak, so weak factorization, and which is a stronger version of Hironaka. But in fact, it's not needed, so I prefer not to use it. What Hironaka just tells us that after a sequence of blow up here, you can make your rational map phi into a true morphism. Now this morphism is of degree one. Now the point is that for invariant, cohomological invariant of that type, we have a pullback in cohomology. But also push forward. And this is here, it's really very important to play, to use projective, that is a compact Lorentzian. So you have this Fakila, so the Gissin morphism, which goes the other way. And the point is that they satisfy the condition that Fikilda lower star composed with Fikilda upper star is the identity, so this is called the projection formula of H3 of YZ. Okay? And so now you consider the map. In fact, it is independent of the designalization. You consider tau lower star composed with phi tilde upper star from H3 of YZ, or maybe I can do directly from the torsion of H3 of YZ to the torsion of H3 of XZ. Okay. Now, because of this formula, you see that phi tilde upper star is injective. And now, because of the previous steps, this is an isomorphism. And so you conclude that this map is injective. And to show that it is surjective, in fact, you will differently. You will desingularize not phi, but rather its inverse. So you will do something like that. You will make a blow up here in such a way that this is the inverse map, which is which becomes a morphism. Okay, and then what you show is that the same map, which is phi, now it becomes phi minus one lower star composed with tau prime upper star. You show that it is a surjective. So this is the same, but now we show that it is surjective. And why is it surjective? Because the tau prime upper star is an isomorphism by the case of blow-ups, and the phi minus one lower star, it is surjective by this formula applied to phi minus one. So I wanted to make this proof completely to show you exactly what is used. And now let me introduce an invariant, another geometric invariant, which at first sight will look of a rather different nature. We used with Coulier-Tellen to denote it like this, and Coulier-Tellen maybe also with Soulet. So this is defined as follows. So again, X will be smooth and projective, or maybe projective is not needed here. So you start from H4 of XZ, and inside we have what can be called the algebraic cohomology. So it is, by definition, generated over Z by cycle classes. So that means that you consider Z contained in X, which is a codimension 2 closed algebraic subset. And we know that even if it has singularities, it has a fundamental homology class, the long result. And because it has a homology class, it has also a cohomology class. And by Poincaré duality on X, and that will be the class of Z in H4 of X. Okay, and more generally, we consider cycle classes, that is Z is a combination with integer coefficients of such such classes. Okay, and and now the group Z4 of X is defined as the torsion of H4 of X Z modulo the Z4. So there is a remark to make here, which is that a priori, it's not needed for the rest, and in particular, if I was working not over C, that remark will not make sense. But somehow, of course, it is related to the Hodge conjecture because we are looking at cycle classes. But it is related in the following sense. You can consider HDG4 of XZ inside H4 of XZ, which is the set of integral Hodge classes. That is, this is simply a set of integral cohomology classes, which, when you consider them as complex cohomology classes, are of type 2 in the Hodge decomposition. So the Hodge decomposition, you see it when looking at cohomology with complex coefficients. And it is almost obvious. So of course, we know this is the starting point of the Hodge conjecture, is that that the algebraic part is contained of in the set of Hodge classes. The Hodge conjecture predicts that this inclusion becomes an isomorphism when you tensor with Q coefficient. And one remark, which is a really stupid remark, it's not a contribution to the Hodge conjecture, is that Z4 of X is also the torsion of HDG4 of X. Okay. So this is simply because, there is an obvious inclusion of this into this. And conversely, if you have a class in here, which is of torsion, that means that is a certain class alpha, such that a multiple is algebraic. If a multiple is algebraic, that means that a multiple is of type 2-2. So the multiple is a Hodge class. So in fact, we are already here. So this is a completely stupid remark. But the reason why I make this remark is that it's a fact which is due to essentially Conté, Mureux, maybe more generally, in a more general setting by Bloch and Srinivas, that if X is rationally connected then the Hodge conjecture for degree 2, for degree 4, sorry, rational Hodge classes on X is true. And another way of formulating this rational Hodge conjecture is exactly saying that this group is in fact already completely of torsion. So in that case, that becomes identically this group. So that's why sometimes on things to this group Z4 of X as measuring the defect of the Hodge, integral Hodge conjecture for degree 4 integral Hodge classes. And then we have similar lemma as before. Z4 of X is stable by rational invariant of, and it's important to insist on X being smooth and predictive. And the proof is exactly follows the similar steps as before. So you show invariant and x the equivalent to x cross some p to the r. The point is that if you consider h dg4 of x z. Sorry, of x cross PR z, it is the same as HTG4 of x z, pulled back by the first projection. Plus, here you have to put HTG2 of x z, and if R is at least 2, you have a copy of HDG 0 of XZ. Well, it's a standard projective bundle formula which tells you this. And now this is, so now of course, this group modulo the algebraic classes that I am considering, but this is known to be algebraic by the Lefschetz 1-1 theorem, a sort of a miracle which says that the Hodge conjecture in that case holds true with the integrand coefficient. And obviously, this one is algebraic. And so, now this is you conclude that modulo algebraic classes, you didn't change the. So you didn't change, and step two, exactly similar, invariance under blow-up. Again, on use the blow-up formula for not only for cohomology, but for cohomology with Hodge structures. And now you have a Z, a smooth Z inside X that you blow up. You want the blow-up formula, which are decomposition into Hodge structures, will tell you that the new classes that you get, there is the pullback of Hodge classes on integral Hodge classes on X, plus those which come from by the same. Same construction as before, those which come from Z. Okay. Plus, maybe that comes, that arrives only if the codimension of Z is at least 2, sorry, at least 3. So you might have another term. Like this. And same remark as before, this is algebraic by Lefschetz 1 theorem, and this is algebraic. So finally, the conclusion is that the new Hodge classes that you have added, they are algebraic. So when you mod out by algebraic cohomology, you get the same group. Okay, so we have invariance under blow-up, and then that's it, because I took the pain of explaining the formalism which allows to deduce the general case of birational transformation from the blow-up, just the invariance under blow-up. And the key point is this functoriality. And so yesterday I made another proof for a stable birational invariance of the pluriforms. And the proof was a very different nature, in fact, because I didn't have at all the same functoriality. So, okay, so. Oh. Okay, so that's the first part of my talk, and now what I want to do is to explain that there's two invariants, namely the Artin Mumford invariant and this invariant playing on the defect of the integral Hodge conjecture in degree 4. They are part of an infinite series of cohomological, it's not exactly cohomological, it's a cohomological versus K-theoretical invariance for algebraic variety. And this is what I want to explain now. To define a ramified cohomology, I am going to assume only that X is smooth, not projective, because that would be too restrictive and it would be counterproductive. So I'm going to do that in the setting of complex geometry, but of course you can imagine translating if you are over another field, particularly the bracket is closed, you can do etal cohomology and do exactly the same thing I will be doing in a different cohomological theory. So the ramified cohomology, so it was essentially defined by Collier-Pellen and Olanguren. In a paper in 83, something like that. Maybe 88, maybe. The problem is that I should not use that proof, first of all, because there is no resolution of the singularities in general. I should use a completely different proof, and in some sense that will come tomorrow. Because in fact, and that will be part of what I'm going to tell, this invariant, which was presented in maybe in a topological way, in fact it is also the Brauer group, or it turns out that for this rationally connected variety, it is the Brauer group. So it has a very good birational invariance property, and the right language to express this birational invariance is more the language of precisely decomposition of the diagonal, for example. And that, but it's true that using resolution of singularities, it's not very good from that viewpoint. But it's quicker. Okay, so there was this paper. I don't remember, maybe it was 88, I'm not exactly sure. I think that also Bogomolov had similar ideas. The fact is that these definitions are built up on a Bloch August theory that I will explain quickly. It's not that. Not that hard, and that also that might become extremely important if the work of Joseph Ayoub confirms to be successful, because really, so this Bloch-August theory has been invented in the 1970 or 74, I think. And that was something spectacular, but then people didn't do that much with it. And maybe it is becoming to be very important very soon. So what they do is very simple. So you consider your X. I have not been very careful differentiating the X as an algebraic variety and as an analytic variety, but now I am going to be. So what I will call X is the set of complex points, which has two topologies, the analytic topology. So it's X of C, so seen as a complex manifold, so analytic or usual topology, and the Zariski topology. So when I say X, I am really thinking as X of C. And this is also the advantage of working over C. You can work with a set of points instead of doing sites or things like that. And so now you have your topological space with two topologies, and the map here, this is simply the identity of a point, and it is simply changing the topology. So it's a continuous map. And what does the Bloch-August theory is simply the Lorentz spectral sequence of this continuous map. So the Lorentz spectral sequence, it introduces, so now you fix A, which is an abelian group, that you see as a constant shift on your X an. And of course, you are interested in computing this. And you will be, you will compute it by studying this Lorentz spectral sequence. And for this, you introduce the shifts on X zar. So they are defined as the derived L derived shifts of A. So if you like, so this is by definition the shift associated the pre-shift, which to you, so this is the shift in the Zariski topology. To you, it will be open Zariski open set will associate. So this is the pre-shift H L of U an, and here is the S. Okay. So that defines the pre-shift. You take the associated shift, and by definition, this is okay. So this is just a definition of the Lorentz spectral sequence. It's just a formalism which will tell you that there is a spectral sequence which starts with like this. So this is the definition. And now a normified cohomology in that setting is this HI NR if it was non ramified. So this is one of these groups. More precisely, you consider H0 of X zar HIFA. So now I want to explain what is known about these groups, and in particular why it gives a stable birational invariant. So for this, I need to say more about Bloch-August theory, and the main important result of Bloch and August is a so-called Gersten-Killen resolution for these shifts. And in particular, that will give as a byproduct the stable birational invariants of this group. So this is as you will see, this terminology of unramified is a little strange from the viewpoint of complex geometry. One should think to a sort of cohomology with no residues. But for the strangely, they think in terms of ramification. It's coming from more from arithmetic. So the Block-Agus, the main Block-Agus result is Block-Agus resolution of HI of A. This is often it's called Gersten-Killen because it mimics the analogous resolution for the K-theory shifts by Gersten and Killen. So I am going just to show how it looks like. So when you have a D which is irreducible, what I will denote by HI of C of D A, that will be by definition the direct limit over all Zariski open set. Zariski open the dense, of course, so that is non-empty, of HI of U and so this is just a group, and that will be seen as a constant shift supported on D. Okay? And so now the Block-Agus resolution looks like this. So the important point to know with this resolution is that there are residues. So now you suppose that this is of codimension one, and let's assume that D is normal. So that means that generically along D prime, both will be smooth. Okay? And then, so this is a closed of codimension one. It's a divisor. And then you have a residue like this. So this is essentially part of the long exact sequence of the relative cohomology. Of D minus D prime, well, essentially plus some Thom isomorphism. So it's a basically, it's nothing that's a standard residue theory. So now the Block-Agus resolution looks like this. So you have this shift on which is a shift on X czar, and then you map it into so this is a constant shift with this very big stalk. And then you have all the residues. Okay, so there are all the residues along divisors. So you should, as I said, you should consider this as a constant shift supported on D. So you push it forward, and this is a constant shift supported on D, which is itself contained in X. And you continue. You will have a irreducible here. Of course, you consider only the irreducible D, and then you will continue taking residues. And then, of course, as the dimension stop decreases at each step, but at the end you will get simply a plus over codimension of Z equal to I. Because I started from I, I decrease, and at the end I get H0 of C of Z A, which is just a copy of A supported on each for each Z irreducible of codimension I. So it's A, so really the thing to, so if you have the inclusion of Z in X, this thing is a GZ work star of the constant shift on Z. Okay, so why is this a complex? So this is by the standard properties of the residue. So has to show that the successive differential product, the composition of successive differential is zero, and that is really a very standard fact about residues. That so when you have a class here alpha, which is defined on the complement of two codimension one thing, so you can first take the residue here. And then we get something which is defined on this open set, and then you can consider the second residue on the intersection. But you can do the other way: first take the residue on the second component, and then take the other residue here. And it turns out that the two operations differ by a sign, and that's exactly the reason finally where you get delta composed with delta equals zero. Okay, so you have a complaint, and the main result of the theory is this. So this is a resolution of HI of A. Or if you like, if this complex is exact, and I see this as a resolution of this shift HI of A. And the important point to note is that, in fact, this resolution is acyclic for the Zariski topology. And the reason why it is acyclic for the Zariski topology is that all the terms, they are made of a constant shift supported on the algebraic subvariety. But if you have a constant shift on an algebraic variety, it is acyclic for the Zariski topology. But in some sense, it's very stupid, but also very, very interesting. Now, the whole, of course, the whole power of the theory is that statement that you get a resolution. So let me say one thing about I am absolutely not going to prove this. It's the hard part of the paper. But already, what is it saying? So even the first step, the fact that this map, so this one, it's not, of course, it's not given by residues, it's just given by restrictions. I recall that, so here, this is the limit of the cohomology of the Zariski open set, and here, it takes into account the cohomology of all Zariski. So now, if you have a Zariski open set, a cohomology class on it, you go to the limit, and that gives this map. So what says the fact that this map is injective at the shift level? In fact, this is essentially a moving lemma for cohomology, because the injectivity here means exactly the following. Suppose that I have a U contained in X. I have a class alpha in HI of U1A. And assume there exists a smaller Zariski open set when I go to the limit with the property that alpha restricted to V is equal to zero. Then in fact, U is covered by open set VI with the VG with the property that alpha restricted to VG is equal to zero. This is, if you recall the definition of this shift, HI script. This is exactly the meaning of this injectivity. And so you see that this is a moving lemma because in the sense that this condition, it is saying that your class alpha is supported on a closed set U minus V. And this conclusion, it is saying that it, in fact, you can make it supported on closed subset, which avoid any point. That's exactly. So I think that expressed like this, it is in fact easier to prove that first step. Okay, so. So now, this is a hard result, but what is very beautiful is that there are plenty of consequences of this this statement. So the corollaries. First of all, that resolution will allow to compute these species. Just using the fact that we have an acyclic resolution, so when you consider that allows to compute the HP with value in HQ, just by taking global section, so I get that. So I took the Q of A, so this is this HP of X star HQ, so is computed by taking global sections. And so the global sections are here. So I am not going to write the general formula, but so first of all, because you have, well, maybe let me say it just in the case of, in two cases, the case of the edge zero and the last case. So in particular, so this is here you just use the injectivity edge zero of HQ of A. Okay, so it's by definition it's our unramified cohomology of X with value in A is the kernel of HQ of C of X A. The kernel of all these residues map. Q over D of HQ minus 1 of C of D. So that's why I said that unramified cohomology should be rather understood as a cohomology without residues. This is exactly what it is from this formula. And now, as a corollary, you get the following. Unramified cohomology is stable by rational invariant of X. And here, so let me be careful. I think so let me. Smooth is clear. Whether I should put yes, smooth of course, of X smooth and projective. Yeah. And the proof is exactly the same I gave yesterday for the stable birational invariance of pluriforms. The reason is that from the formula that you see that is written here, you get. That this does not change when you replace X by x minus z, where codimension of z is at least 2. That's clear because you have the formula here. It involves only C of X, of course, a birational invariant, and then the C of D, where the D are a codimension one thing. So you don't see the codimension two thing in the formula. And so this was exactly the key point yesterday to prove birational invariance of the pluriforms. The other point is that this restricts injectively on Zariski open set. So that was also used yesterday. You can restrict. I didn't say where it is used, but the fact that it restricts injectively, it's, of course, it is here. Okay, so. Here, I did not prove that it is a stable birational invariant, but that needs other tools. Okay. So now let me, it's all full of generalities. I first state two more consequences of this Bloch-Eggers resolution. The first one is the following vanishing that A2 PQ is zero for P greater than Q. And this is very clear because you see that, here I put, maybe I should say, I should put a I if you like. It's because the HI of A, it has an acyclic resolution of the length I. So no cohomology. Okay, so that's clear. The second point is, it's a very important fact for the theory of algebraic cycles, is the Bloch-Eggers formula, where now you compute the last non-zero term appearing, namely A2 II of X, let's say with Z coefficient. So by definition, it's HI of X ZAR, with value in HI of Z. We use this resolution, as I said, because it's an acyclic resolution, we just have to take the global section. And what I get, I take H0 of this. This is, just, as I said, that just produce a copy of Z for each codimension codimension I subset. So by definition, the H0 will be the group of codimension I cycles on X with Z coefficient. And then one has to understand what is arriving here. So the last term will be plus for codimension of Z equal to I minus 1 of H1 of C of maybe W Z, or maybe A. So you have the residues. And here, it's a small complex analysis will tell you that what you get here are finally all the cycles which are homologous to zero in something which is one dimension higher. So, it really goes back to standard complex analysis. And so finally, the conclusion is that we get here the group of Z homologous to zero in some W, which is of codimension I minus one. And in fact, this is exactly the subgroup of cycles algebraically equivalent to zero. So finally, the group that we get here, it's the group of cycles, sometimes Zi of X modulo, so if you like modulo algebraic. Okay, so that's known as a Blocker-Gauss formula, and it's really very, very important. That says that these cycles modulo algebraic equivalence, they are essentially, we know very well now that they control very much the theory of motifs, because when you are algebraically equivalent to zero, you have a nilpotence result. So really the structure of motifs is governed by cycles modulo algebraic equivalence. And this formula, it says that we have a sort of cohomological formula for this group of cycles modulo algebraic equivalence. Okay, but finally, the last point, which is which is important, is that now let me. I look to be very far from the beginning of the lecture, and it's not true, because. Now, what happened to this Leray spectral sequence? You see that the EI, this one, let's now do it with Z coefficient. It is the deepest term in the Leray spectral sequence by the vanishing that we have here. And so, and furthermore, so there are no differentials coming from here because of these vanishings. So you conclude that in fact this one it admits as a quotient the A infinite II. Maybe there are some dears arriving. Sometimes usually very complicated. And the point is that this one, it is the deepest term in the Leray filtration, also by this vanishing. And so finally, we get we have this just as the deepest term of this Leray filtration. And now the one thing that you can so we proved this, that this is this group here, we just computed it. It's a cycles. Modulo algebraic equivalence. And one result, I think it's more or less proved by in Blocker-Gauss, is that this map here is a cycle class. So of course, it's a very complicated way to express the cycle class, but now we can take advantage of some further results that we have about the HI. Okay, so now let me. Let me give so this was the general theory. So the application is this theorem. Well, this one is really obvious. Let X be rationally connected. So the first part is obvious. Then, again, smooth projective. Then, we get that the invariant, the Artinum for invariant, is nothing but H2 unramified of X with a value in Q over Z. So that will be essentially the same proof. Here, this one is more difficult. So this is due to Collier-Tellen and myself. And I think, something like this. The second group that I mentioned, so that re-explain a posteriori why we got stable birational invariant. The group Z4 of X, again under this assumption that X is rationally connected, it is the same as H3 unramified. So I am maybe going to explain how this works. So but first of all, a crucial point, which is very recent, and it's why that result appears only here, why it could have been in some sense proved in the 70s at the same time Okay, so maybe I can continue. So the reason why this result has not been proved at the time of Bloch-Eugus is that there is a very new ingredient in the proof, which is the following theorem. This is in fact a consequence of a Bloch-Kato conjecture. The sheaves which pi of z have no z torsion. So the Bloch-Kato conjecture has been proved by Vojvodsky, also maybe Rost, contribution of Rost. So this is, if you think, this is saying something very deep on the topology of complex manifold, complex algebraic manifold. It is saying that if you have an algebraic, complex algebraic variety, smooth, you have a torsion cohomology class on it. It is supported on a proper closed algebraic subset. So it's quite remarkable. And then using this, so as a rather easy corollary, one gets that if X is rationally connected, then the unramified cohomology group of X with Z coefficients are zero in positive degree. It's essentially because it's not very hard to show that there are torsion, and on the other hand, this result shows that there is never any torsion. So the easy part is to show that there are torsion, and the hard part is to use that. Okay, and then let me finish with a short explanation concerning this. It's by okay, so I recall that I want to examine the torsion of H4 of XZ modulo H4 of XZ and. But now with the Bloch-Eugus theory, it's very good to say what is this H4 of XZ alge. It is simply the deepest term in the Leray filtration associated, which is called the coniveau filtration. Okay. So now you consider the possible A2PQ, that appear when you compute this Bloch-Eugus spectral sequence. There are only, so you have the A2-2-2. This one will lead to that term. Then you will have A2-3-1, and then A2-4-0. They are the one which will contribute to H4 of XZ, because the other ones vanish by the vanishing that I had written before. So this one is H0 of H4Z, so it will be zero. And this one, you can note that also because of the same vanishing, and just formally, it is A infinite. So the conclusion is that so now we have this A infinite 2-2 here, which whose image is basically the image is identically this. And finally, what I conclude is that H4 of X, okay, so this is by for X rationally connected, this H4 of XZ mod H4 of XZ it is the same as, in fact, this A231, H1 of X, with value in H3 of Z. So finally, the torsion here which we are interested. It is the torsion of this. But now we can use this very deep result that these shifts have no torsion, and that gives an exact sequence. So the fact that these shifts have no torsion, that shows that the long exact sequence related to the inclusion of Z into Q produce, in fact, a series of short exact sequences like this. And now we just do the long exact sequence associated to that, and we find H0 of XR, H3 of Q over Z. And here I get H1 of H3Z. And here it's a torsion. And here the H0 is zero because X is rationally connected, and that gives me this isomorphism. So finally, I exactly prove what I wanted. Okay, so I stop here.
Connected, can you put some other assumption there?
Yes, absolutely. For example, this result, let's see, the vanishing of this, for example, here, the vanishing of unramified cohomology with Z coefficient, it will be true more generally. So let's see, yes. If X has what is needed exactly? Yes. For example, C0 of X. Z is quite enough to imply this. So why this is true? This is that here, of course, I need absolutely Bloch-Srinivas. In principle, that will come from starting from tomorrow. This is because Bloch-Srinivas will show that if you have this assumption, then you have a cohomological decomposition of the diagonal, and this cohomological decomposition of the diagonal will be only with Q coefficients. So now, but that is enough to imply that unramified cohomology. It's not the cohomological decomposition of the diagonal; it's the Chow decomposition of the diagonal that you need for that. So it holds with Q coefficient. That implies that unramified cohomology with Q coefficient is a zero. And then the no torsion result of which is here implies that you have this vanishing with Z coefficient. So in fact, this result holds with a much much weaker assumption. Also, the Bloch-Srinivas result, I will talk very much about that starting from tomorrow, has other implications. For example, the fact that the Hodge conjecture with Q coefficients holds for degree 4 Hodge classes. It's true assuming only that CH0 of X is supported on something of dimension at most 3, for example. Again, by this formalism of decomposition of the diagonal. So you are right. In fact, our result with the Coyote-Lane needs a weaker assumption.